One of us at a time needs to talk. And next break will be at 2:50. Who in this room will let me know when it's 2:50? You're on. Thank you. Questions? Is your mind working about what you're going to be doing, how you're going to be doing it? And maybe I didn't make something clear, but let me... Yeah, he has a question. Yes, go for it. You can't hear me. Jeez. Can you... Then whoever's responsible, can we get somebody for the volume to turn the volume up? Can you find somebody? Are you guys having a hard time hearing me in the back, too? We need to turn the volume up. Maybe if somebody could do that, that would be great, because they have a hard time hearing me. And I'm talking as loud. And part of the problem is, when I'm really loud, it feels like I'm in your face and in your space, but they can't hear me back there. So excuse me when I seem overly loud. So hopefully you're sort of processing and thinking about how you're going to move ahead with some of these things and make some of these things happen. No other questions? Yes, ma'am. Go for it. I think about people who don't smile, that they are not, they have never been provided informed consent. No, honestly. I really think they've never had anybody in their life who has valued them enough to sit down with them and explain to them how their facial affect impacts their relationship with other people. I think if everyone really understood how it impairs the relationship, they would make a decision to do everything they could to put a smile on their face. Now, obviously, there are people who want to invalidate that by saying this, well, you know, I have a migraine headache. How can I smile? I don't expect people to smile when they have a migraine headache. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about people have a persistent state of misery. When my mother passed away, I didn't walk away from the funeral smiling. You got my drift. I mean, we don't want to invalidate the concept, but I think they don't have informed consent. The other thing, like that gentleman, they have demons. And I can spin, and the reason I'm talking about the smile, the eye contact, the sense of humor, is because coaching is all based on relationships. Make sure you got it. If you don't have a relationship with your staff, you're not going to be able to coach. You can be a supervisor, you can be a manager, but you can't coach. Because coaching precludes consequence. In other words, if I'm a manager and I hear or see that you do something that's inappropriate or wrong, I can give you a written consequence. I can suspend you. You could even be terminated. But that's management. This is coaching. So the only thing you have going for you as a coach is the relationship that you have with the staff. If you don't have the relationship, why would they pay any attention to you? Who cares? Because what you're trying to do is increase, this is key, your likability factor. That's what you're really trying to do. You've got to be likable. And you get these people who say, well, this is not a likability contest. I'm not here to be likable. And very simple. Either you're likable or you're not. Because when you're likable, what results? And you'll see it. I spent a lot of time in the book talking about this particular point. And that's bonding. And that word was never in my vocabulary. Bond. Because the reason it wasn't in my vocabulary, behaviorists don't use a word like bond. Because it's difficult to empiricize, operationally define. In the book, I've operationally defined the word bond. And this is what I believe. I said it yesterday. I believe that when you bond with people, they're less likely to behave in a way to disappoint you. So as a coach, if you don't have the relationship with the staff, when you walk out there, they go back doing the same damn thing they did before. You know, I'll have a manager come up to me and say, Tom, boy, I've been working with my staff. I've been showing them this, showing them that. And you know, then I leave, and I find out they went back to do the same thing they did before. That manager is so naive. You know what they told me? They have no relationship with their staff. Why would their staff care? They don't care. But when you bond with people, they want to behave in a way not to disappoint you. So bond, bond, bond. And again, remember the thing on bonding. The way I bond with my wife is different than the way I bond with my daughters. It's different than, right? Because bonding, like likability, is always influenced by the roles and functions that we hold. You can't coach without bonding. Okay, somebody asked me to read a poem. I wasn't going to read any of the same ones from yesterday or today, but they said, I really would like some of the staff to hear it. So I will repeat this poem, and then I'm going to do one that I didn't do. I said I was going to read it this morning, and somehow I skipped it, okay? And this poem is entitled, "With Interest from All My Dearest Caregivers." Can you guys hear me in the back okay? Okay. Let's see how that works. Is that too loud? Is that too loud, or is that okay? Okay, good. "Of Interest to All My Dearest Caregivers. I'm sorry you have to go through all this unpleasantness every day, and I regret that I am the cause of it. I hate not being able to do so many things for myself. It's awful to be totally dependent on someone else. I feel ashamed that I can't go to the bathroom on my own. It's frustrating to be fed by another person. I'm absolutely disgusted that I'm unable to get a tissue up to my face so I can blow my nose. Being helpless does things to one's feeling of personal worth. Worst of all is knowing how you hate being my caregiver. I see the resentment in your eyes, and I hear it in your voice. I know that deep down, you wish not to be bothered with me. Well, I wish the same. Surprised? I have no choice, but I have to live out the years that have been allotted to me. I'm sorry that the job of caring for me has fallen on your shoulders. I wonder which of us carries the bigger burden. And as I said yesterday, in my opinion, if the men and women who we support ever found their voice, that's what many of them would be saying. Now with that, I would like to read you the poem I was going to read you this morning, but somehow got skipped. Oh, I know, I did skip it intentionally because you told me that you'd already heard it. It's my other brother, Daryl.
They haven't all heard it.
Okay, well, those of you who have heard it, you mind if I just do it again for those who haven't? Because I really like it. And now, what's important about this poem, this is important, it was published in 1987. Some of you may not have been born in 1987. So if it was published in 1987, it was written before 1987. That's an important point. So here we go. And there's a little preface about Daryl before we get into the poem. He's 18 years old. He has a moderate to severe handicap. He's been in school for 12 years. Never been served in any setting other than in an elementary school, even though he's 18. He's had a number of years of individualized instruction. He has learned to do a lot of things. Are you ready? Daryl can now do lots of things he couldn't do before. He can put 100 pegs in a board in less than 10 minutes while in his seat with 95% accuracy. But he can't put quarters in vending machines. Upon command, he can touch nose, shoulder, leg, foot, hair, ear. He's still working on wrist, ankle, and hips. But he can't blow his nose when needed. He can do a 12-piece Big Bird puzzle with 100% accuracy and color an Easter bunny and stay in the lines. But he prefers music, but was never taught how to use a radio or a record player. He can now fold primary paper in halves and even quarters, but he can't fold his clothes. He can sort blocks by color up to 10 different colors, but he can't sort clothes white from colors for washing. He can roll Play-Doh and make wonderful clay snakes, but he can't roll bread dough and cut out biscuits. He can string beads in alternating colors and match it to a pattern on a DLM card, but he can't lace his shoes. He can sing his ABCs and tell me names of all the letters of the alphabet when presented on a card in uppercase with 80% accuracy, but he can't tell the men's room from the ladies' room when we go to McDonald's. He can be told it's cloudy, rainy, take a black felt cloud, put it on the day of the week on a large calendar without assistance, but he still goes out in the rain without a raincoat or a rain hat. He can identify with 100% accuracy 100 different Peabody picture cards by pointing, but he can't order a hamburger by pointing to a picture or gesturing. He can walk a balance beam frontwards, sideways, and backwards. But he can't walk up the steps or bleachers unassisted in the gym to go to a basketball game. He can count to 100 by rote memory, but he doesn't know how many dollars to pay the waitress for a $2.59 McDonald's coupon special. He can put a cube in the box, under the box, beside the box, and behind the box, but he can't find the trash bin in McDonald's and empty his trash into it. You ready for the killer? He can sit in a circle with appropriate behavior and sing songs and play duck, duck, goose, goose, but nobody else in the neighborhood his age seems to want to do that. I guess he's just not ready yet. 1987. Do you want to come with me next week? Do you want to see what I am going to see when I go into these day programs? And anybody in the room take offense that I call them day wasting programs. Not shame on me, shame on you. You want to see what I'm going to see next week? There's nothing new. We've known treating people poorly won't improve the quality of their life. You know, if the computer chip industry would innovate at the same rate we do in human services, we'd still be doing math with an abacus. Because there's nothing new. We've got to move it forward, friends. Celebrate. Thank people for doing well. Thank them. Show appreciation in concrete and public ways. And, you know, there are some staff that can't deal with that. My mom, oh my gosh, she couldn't even take a compliment on a one-to-one. I mean, she said, "Mom, boy, dinner was great. You're such a good cook." And everyone thought my mom was a good cook. "Oh, no, I'm not a good cook." She couldn't accept the compliment. "Mom, you look so lovely. We'd be going someplace. I really like your..." No. Do you know, I have no photos of my mom with my children, her grandchildren. She would never allow me to take her picture. And I've always considered her an attractive woman. I mean, my mom passed away at the age of 93. So if there were something and I was giving my mom accolades at some kind of event, she'd be crawling under the table. You have staff like that. There are some people in this room who are like that. So what do? You got to make sure that the appreciation that you show them is on a one-to-one basis, because they're not comfortable with who they are. They don't see themselves as a good and valued human being. Certainly my mother did. But think about our society. Our society is all about accolade. When was it? Sunday night, they had the Globe Awards, right? People coming up and people clapping thousands. We have the Olympics. They put them on these round things and put necklaces on their head. But that's what our whole society is about, is public accolade. And it's unfortunate that some people can't receive it because they don't see themselves as good and valued human beings. Some staff, even though when you may approach them and put something in the form of a question, you know, and you're helping them come up with the answer, the epiphany, there are some staff that are so fragile that we have to use what is called, and this is important to remember, Oreo cookie, okay? The Oreo cookie, it's an important concept. It's been around for a long time. I should be able to go up to somebody who is a healthy human being. Let's go back to my standard metaphor. Somebody comes up behind somebody who uses a wheelchair, right? And I say, "You know, I noticed Bill startled. Do you have any thoughts or things that you might do to be able to approach him without him startling?" That's how you should be able to talk to a healthy human being, right? There's nothing wrong with that. There are some people that can't deal with that. So you've got an Oreo cookie now. What does that look like? "Boy, I've been watching you. You have such a great relationship with Bill. I have none of the other staff connect with him the way you do. I mean, he was very cooperative and willing to do a lot of things with you." You know, I know that sometimes when you come up to Bill, that he startles when you come up to him. Do you have any thoughts on what you might be able to do to stop him from startling? "Oh, that's a good idea." And again, I really want to thank you for the outstanding job you're doing with Bill. Y'all follow what we're doing here? Yeah, it's a positive comment, and it's important. You got to learn this stuff. You're not going to connect with some of these staff. A positive comment, an issue of concern, and a positive comment. The strategy is disarming. And all you can hope is that your significant other is not someone who you have to engage in Oreo cookie. I mean, it destroys a relationship. If you have a relationship with a significant other, and you can't talk to that person directly that way, and you have to do that dance, you're going to wear yourself out. If you have too many staff who you have to Oreo cookie, it's exhausting. You just can't do it. But There are people who are good people and can be good staff, but they're so fragile that when you approach them, you have to Oreo cookie them. So show appreciation. Celebrate the efforts of staff by providing a simple verbal job well done. Which reminds me, this is totally unrelated. You ever hear staff to the people they support? Good job. Good job. Good job. Enough of the good job award. What is that? I have this little sheet that says 100 ways to say good job. Is that, when you go to a preschool program, that's what they say. Why can't they say outstanding? Excellent. I really appreciate that. You're really a good worker. I mean, there's 1,000, but because the staff see them as children in adult bodies, they would give them, I'm not making this up. Listen to what many of these staff say. Good job, good job, good job. And it's not by accident that they say that. It's how they see the person. And by the way, you've got to be very careful because the passive-aggressive staff, if you suggest they use alternatives, this is the response. My supervisor says I wasn't supposed to tell people that they're doing good. You're not supposed to tell them that. You can't acknowledge them.